Everything begins with an idea, and the idea begins, as the Bible reminds us, with the Word. And I would like the Word to go out that the United States is committing itself to the fact that this, to the possibility that this world and everything in it can be made safe and fit for human habitation.
Norman Cousins is adjunct professor of medical humanities at the UCLA School of Medicine. For 35 years, he was editor of the Saturday Review magazine. One of the founders of public television in the United States, he served as chairman of the predecessor organization to the Corporation for Public Broadcasting. Mr. Cousins is a recipient of numerous awards. Among them are the United Nations Peace Medal and the Personal Medallion of Pope John XXIII. He holds honorary degrees in literature, science, and law from 49 colleges and universities. He believes that if nuclear war should occur, it will come about not because it was inevitable, but because not enough people took the trouble to avert it. You're basically an optimist when it comes to what people can create with their minds and put into effect, that it is possible if people are willing to think about new solutions to work toward them. So how would you have us approach this creating a better order? There's no national anthems for the world. There are national anthems for each of us with our individual units.
I think we begin with the fact that we can extend our pride in belonging to a nation, to our pride in belonging to a species. After all, it's the most privileged species in the universe.
Mm-hmm.
We can look around the solar system and recognize that nowhere else in this solar system, at least, do we have the millions of conditions in such precise and exquisite combination that make human life possible.
Mm-hmm.
And this is the highest prize, I think. Human life is the highest prize that the universe has to offer. I think a proper appreciation of the value of life, the uniqueness of life and the preciousness of life,
mm-hmm.
should give us some sense, and can, of belonging to that particular species. Then the next step is to try to develop a survival instinct for the species, to go along with the survival instinct of the individual and the survival instinct of the nation. I have hope that by making our identification with the life and the rarity of it and the preciousness of it, that we'll begin to think about the conditions of life itself,
mm-hmm.
not just in a physical way, but in historical, philosophical, psychological, even spiritual ways. What is required to enable a species to fulfill itself?
Mm-hmm.
How do we safeguard the conditions of life on this planet at a time when the predatory instincts, and here I have to put instincts in quotes because mm-hmm. I'm not sure they are that, where the predatory instincts of the species are pointed against the species itself.
Mm-hmm.
I think, therefore, that once we begin thinking in larger terms, in terms of not just our pride as a species, but in terms of our need to make our planet safe and fit for human habitation, then we will begin to think of the institutions that can make that possible.
Mm-hmm.
After all, we're living in a very primitive period in human history where we haven't yet emerged from the psychology of the tribe. We haven't yet learned how to protect the human nest.
Mm-hmm.
But as a species, I believe we can evolve. I think we can share our perceptions with one another. We can share our love of life with one another. I think we can begin to think in terms of creating something beyond the nation without eliminating the nation.
Let's take that very hopeful and positive theme and try to relate it to how some of our institutions can help us in that quest. You've written about the fact that in trying to make ourselves more safe than your earlier comment in preserving the safety of the nest, we've succeeded in making everyone's nest no longer safe.
In a sense, that's new in our history. Consequence of four decades of the development of nuclear weapons to the point that they're not weapons anymore, but devices that, if a few of them are used, really destroy the environment for all of us. Government's quite central to that. What does government need to do differently to try to shift from this approach that makes us all unsafe?
Now, there's a rather simplistic, I think, notion that it ought to be possible for nations to resolve their disputes peaceably.
Mm-hmm.
And that assumes, of course, it's predicated on the assumption, which I believe to be fallacious, that the disputes among nations are rather logical.
Mm-hmm.
And that you want something and I want something, and that therefore the thing to do is to sit down and to resolve this. You get 50% and I get 50%.
Mm-hmm.
But the the problem among nations is not just what you want and what I want. The problem tends to be a little more basic than at times, and it changes from time to time.
Mm-hmm.
At one time, it may be represented by a nation which is out for conquest.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not just a matter of resolving a dispute. How do you resolve a dispute with someone who wants it?
Wants it all.
Wants it all. Sure. It's not a dispute at all. And so you have no choice. Germany, for example, was bent on conquest, and that left the rest of the world with a very narrow choice, which is to submit or to struggle.
Mm-hmm.
So we're not really addressing ourselves to the main issue when we say, well, let's resolve a dispute. What we've mm-hmm. got to do is to create the mechanisms which can protect human society. This is what the need is. Yes, we want to be able to resolve disputes where you have disputes that are capable of being resolved. But where you have something a little more fundamental, you want to be able to protect the world's peoples by having specific instruments and institutions capable of doing the job, and that's what we don't have today. And that's why I say we live in a very primitive condition of human society. We think that we can get by with anarchy on the world level. We don't have government. We don't have law on the world level. Therefore, since we don't have government on the world level, we can't have justice. We can't have law.
Where would you begin to change that?
You can only begin, it seems to me, with the desire to change it.
Mm-hmm.
The uniqueness of human beings is represented by their ability to define what it is they want.
Okay, and you've said one of the greatest problems to achieving peace are those individuals who think they can do nothing with their own lives to help achieve it. How would you have individuals take you seriously about the power of what individual people can do and begin to work?
Well, ultimately, this world and everything in it belongs to the people who inhabit it. In the United States, we like to think, or at least we've been told by the American founding fathers, and I believe they're right, that in a good society, the ultimate power belongs to the people.
Mm-hmm.
We now have to recognize that governments, by their very nature, will not move in this direction. The government becomes concerned with its own survival,
mm-hmm.
becomes fearful that anything else that exists may impinge on that power.
Right now, we're more powerful than ever before and less secure at the same time by a quantum difference.
Well, the reason that we're less secure is that our power is not being used in a way that will really increase our security.
Mm-hmm.
And this, of course, is true of all countries. As we go up in power, and as the Russians go up in power, each believes that it's necessary to have power to protect itself against the other, but mm-hmm. the net effect is to make everyone less secure. So it's not going to be possible with the United States and the Soviet Union to arrive by themselves at the kind of agreement, even though I think that they can certainly reduce the temperature.
Mm-hmm.
But even as they do so, they've got to point to something larger, which is that this world is not going to be made whole just by the United States and the Soviet Union working together, if they can in fact agree. Mm-hmm. It's going to be made whole only in terms of something that addresses itself to the whole, which is to say, what form of organization does the world need in order to make sense of our time on Earth and for our children?
How do you answer that question?
I can't think of any way in which peoples can become secure except on the basis of world law, which is to say, to eliminate the present world anarchy and to develop those institutions of world law which can define the relationships among nations and make it unnecessary for nations to fend for power outside their own countries, or even to consume their own resources and vast armaments. I recognize I'm talking theoretically, it's true, and I can think of nothing more difficult than to create a responsible world order, one that will respect the rights of nations and one that will enable, let's say, the United States to retain its own values and its own institutions, but at the same time clearly defining and limiting what this nation or any nation can do outside its own borders.
So the answer for you to the way to a more viable world order, a more peaceful world for us all, is to put a stop to the anarchy that is the current way we do business across societies on this planet, and to put in its place a viable rule of law and world government. You've written that the greatest failure of education today is that it is succeeding in making us all tribe conscious rather than species conscious. What do you mean, and what would you have educators do differently?
When you speak of government in the world, there's always a danger, of course, that people conceive of government in terms familiar to them, which is to say what our government is, what the government of the Soviet Union is. But by government, we're thinking not so much of a government where you would elect people to office as individuals necessarily, and that would replace the United States or the Soviet Union, so much as something that exists on that plane in which the Soviet Union, the United States, and other governments have to, in their own best interest, conform to statutory law, and where the actions of governments outside their own country will be severely limited, but again on the basis of clearly defined code or law, and where you would have, I would suppose, the ability to enact world law, but also the ability to enforce it, and the ability to interpret it so that it's not abused. And I, again, I see a danger in that particular course if, for example, that government should become totalitarian, because then you would really have a George Orwell situation where one government would have total power over the entire world, and that's not what we want. But the best way to prevent that from happening, I think, is to develop a federal structure in which the nations retain authority over their own institutions and preserve their own values, but where the differences among nations yield to clearly defined statutes in their own relationships. What is it the nations should do or can do? What constitutes laws for nations themselves? This is a very big step in terms of human evolution. But if we're really serious about wanting this country to continue, if we're really serious about prizing our freedoms and prizing our history, if we're really serious about safeguarding not just our future, but the human future, then surely we must recognize that you have to create those means by which it is possible. We have now come to a dead end. We now have the means for destroying others, but at the same time destroying ourselves. I don't think that, this represents a justification of our history. The weapons that we are now building are not necessary for any military purpose, because you can destroy an enemy with only a fraction of those weapons. Mm-hmm. What they do represent, therefore, is a psychological projection, of power, where we're trying to mm-hmm. persuade someone about our power, just as they're trying to persuade us. But if the aim, therefore, is to persuade, then we are involved in a psychological enterprise and not just a military one. And if we are involved in a psychological enterprise, then perhaps we ought to bring in professional psychologists mm-hmm. instead of committing the national future to those who think only in terms of, or have to think in terms of force, since this is their training, it's natural. Mm-hmm. And we shouldn't blame them for so doing. But at the same time, we must recognize we have to find some way of safeguarding our values, safeguarding mm-hmm. our future, but also safeguarding the future of the species itself. And this calls for different institutions. And I think we're equal to it.
What roles do you see for religion in working toward a more peaceful world? You've written that the negative role for religion can be emphasizing narrow interests and losing the common humanity. What's the positive side of that?
Well, I believe that the Catholic bishops, in their pastor letter not long ago, were able to define, as they themselves were able to illustrate, the role of religion in the present crisis. Mm-hmm. Because in that pastor letter it was made very clear that the present policy of the governments was not creating security, but was leading to a breakdown of human society. Mm-hmm. I believe that that pastor letter of the Catholic bishops can be used as a rallying point for all religions. Many religious leaders outside Catholicism have praised that letter and have accepted it as a basis for common action and belief. But I do think that we ought to go beyond that, and I would hope that the other religions would either, in a very cohesive and dramatic way, identify themselves with the pastor letter, or else develop a similar statements of their own mm-hmm. where the net effect of all of them can be, I think, highly useful in the human situation today. But I don't think it fair to expect religious leaders alone to carry the struggle. I think it's necessary for all those groups which are concerned with the welfare of their own constituents as well as the welfare of the whole to create a moral imperative. Mm-hmm. The question always comes up, of course, well, what about the Soviet Union? What point is there in making these declarations mm-hmm. if they don't always also speak to the Soviet Union? Here I think it's important to make a reasonable analysis of what the mm-hmm. situation is in the Soviet Union. There is the notion that we are confronted with an implacable communism. And so the first thing we have to do is to say, well, what is communism and where are mm-hmm. the communists? The Soviet society today is not yet a communist society. They like to tell you that, yes, we don't have communism yet, but we're moving in that direction. Mm-hmm. But the fact of the matter is that they've discovered that those elements of communism that they have adopted have not worked. Marx didn't understand production. The five-year plans that the Russians have pursued have not worked. They've tried a number of ways to increase production because you can't be strong unless you can produce. And so they're actually moving away from communism. Mm-hmm. And they're actually introducing incentives in order to increase production. The same thing is true of China. Well, then they say, well, communism represents the destruction of religion. I think the one thing the Russians have learned, or the believers or the Soviet leaders have discovered is that you can't destroy religion. And it was interesting, according to one statistic that I've seen, that there were more baptisms in the Soviet Union last year than in the United States.
Hmm.
So they've been wrong about that too. And yet, we have not yet, it seems to me, assessed what that government really is or how it really operates. It's a form of a municipal capitalism, which is to mm-hmm. say the city owns and operates the businesses inside its own locality. And they do this almost on a corporate basis, where the people who work for it are almost stockholders. I visited a publishing firm in Moscow where they did capitalist bookkeeping, which is what they had a bottom line.
Sure.
And they sold things and they had expenses, and then they had to tally up the two to see whether they're making a profit or not. And when they didn't make a profit, they had to shake up the plan.
Mm-hmm.
And they bring in new managers, because the workers would share in the profits, and therefore they had a stake in profits. Well, I don't think we really understand this, but we have that old stereotype, you see, of dealing with that, just as they have a stereotype of what capitalism is. They don't understand that Marx's analysis of capitalism no longer holds. They don't understand what has happened in terms of management, the managerial revolution mm-hmm. in the United States. They still think in terms of a few families owning these large companies,
mm-hmm.
and you have these predatory capitalists, and they don't understand the fluidity of our society, the fact that mm-hmm. It is possible for anybody, and still is, to move up the ladder and have all these changes. So one of the great ironies of the modern world is that the main threat to American capitalism today is coming not from a communist country. The main threat to American capitalism is coming from another capitalist country, Japan.
Mm-hmm.
Which has discovered ways of producing things superior to our own.
Mm-hmm.
In short, they are using capitalism in a way that produces a higher form of capitalism.
Mm-hmm.
Our automobile industry has been injured not because of competition from the Russians. Our electronic industry is in danger not mm-hmm. because of the Russians. It's being threatened because of better ways of doing things by another capitalist country.
Mm-hmm.
And so what we ought to do is to look at the Japanese and ask ourselves, how is it possible that this capitalist country, with no resources of its own,
mm-hmm.
has been able nonetheless to challenge the mighty United States with all those resources, superior, vast population, greater wealth, even though Japan was destroyed at the end of the last war? And the answer is that Japan's real wealth is in the human mind, and it has recognized it as such.
Mm-hmm.
And at a time when the United States has been cutting back on higher education and support for higher education, the Japanese have been putting everything they possibly can into higher education.
Mm-hmm.
Because they recognize that you don't need physical resources. If you can develop the resources of the human mind, you've tapped the greatest mm-hmm. source of wealth on earth. And this to them is the essence of capitalism, and that is why their form of capitalism so far has been superior to ours.
Mm-hmm.
We have been using our resources and devouring our resources in large part in military spending. Japan doesn't put any money into military mm-hmm. spending, because what Japan has said to itself is that no one is going to win a nuclear war.
Mm-hmm.
And if a nuclear war is going to be fought, everyone is going to lose.
Mm-hmm.
Therefore, what they're going to do in the meantime is to develop their sources of real strength
mm-hmm.
and real wealth in order to upgrade their society.
Mm-hmm.
And no one talks about Japan involved with other countries.
Mm-hmm.
But what we are talking about, it seems to me, is the fact what we should be talking about is the fact that we're dealing with old stereotypes and old mm-hmm. manners. Now, it is true, I believe, that the main threat to our capitalism is coming from another capitalist society because of their realization mm-hmm. of what production requires.
And the role of education.
Especially the role of education. But at the same time, the main threat to Soviet communism is coming not from a capitalist society, but from another communist society, China.
Mm-hmm.
And so you have these twin paradoxes, unrealized but real.
You've written that time is no longer on the side of peace, that the time to achieve a viable world government as time passes is getting harder and harder. How'd you break into this cycle you've identified where within capitalism and within communism and between nations, we're not getting the job done. Where would you have us begin?
Well, when I said that time is not working for us, I didn't mean to suggest that time has run out.
Mm-hmm.
Or that we should act out of desperation because there's so little time. That's not what I had in mind. What I had in mind was that we can't assume that we can be oblivious of what is happening. And it is true that the longer we wait, the tougher it is going to get. I can see no better course for the United States than for its government to announce to the world that the unifying principle of its foreign policy is to make the world whole, and that we're going to use whatever strength we have, and I'm not thinking of physical strength, we'll use the strength of our history, and we will commit ourselves to the notion that this world can be governed, and that what we propose is not that individual nations or governments be abolished or that individual systems be abolished, but rather that we try to create something to which each will make a contribution that can serve the parts. It is difficult to think of any problem today of any dimension that is not global in nature, whether we're talking about the threats to the human environment, the physical environment, whether we're talking about the arms race, whether we're talking about population pressure, whether we're talking about food. These are world problems, but we don't have adequate world instruments to deal with them. And I would hope that the United States would say that the central purpose of our foreign policy will be to bring into being these instruments, which can be effective on the world scale, not just to serve our needs, but to serve the needs of others, and to express our confidence in the fact that it is possible for human resources to be used for human good. Everything begins with an idea, and the idea begins, as the Bible reminds us, with the Word. And I would like the Word to go out that the United States is committing itself to the fact that this world and everything in it can be made safe and fit for human habitation.
Mr. Cousins, thank you for sharing with us today your insights into the ways to a more peaceful world.